You may be seated. Good afternoon, and welcome to the 9th Annual Unsung Heroes Awards. My name is Linda Brooks Burton, and I'm the branch manager at the Bayview Wadden Library in Bayview Hunters Point. And it is my pleasure to introduce our Master of Ceremonies for the afternoon. For 49 years, Dr. Arthur Coleman has been practicing family medicine in Bayview Hunters Point. He has been politically, socially, economically active in this community for the same number of years. Along with his wife, Dr. Coleman co-chaired the African American Affinity Group, which raised nearly $600,000 for the African American Center here at the new Main Library. Dr. Coleman has been a hero in our community for many, many years. How appropriate it is to have him help us recognize our unsung heroes here today. Please help me welcome Dr. Arthur Coleman.
Thank you very much, Linda, and good afternoon to everyone. It's a real privilege and pleasure for me to serve as your Master of Ceremonies this afternoon. And I say that for several reasons. First of all, as I understand it, and this is a this affair today is a joint effort between Western Addition, Ocean View, and Bayview Hunters Point. And I think that's so important that the library branches are coming together and have, in unison, put on this affair today. The second reason why I'm so happy and feel so glad that you're here is that I hope each and every one of you, if you have not, will avail yourselves of the opportunity to see the African American Center on the third floor. It's a beautiful part of this building, and this building itself is beautiful, and I think you will be very proud of our representation in this part of the library. What I would like to do first, before making a presentation of awards, is to have another selection from that young and gifted choir. We enjoyed that first one, I'm sure everyone did, and I know they will give us great spirit and great uplift in their next song.
Talk about the children born, but I'm not tired.
wonderful way to start our program, young and gifted, so much needed. We're going to take the program a little out of order in terms of the awardees. And so when I call the awardee's name, would that person please start coming forward, and that'll save a little time. First, we're going to have Hazel L. King. Mrs. King was born in Arkansas, but moved to California with her husband in 1951. As the mother of six children, she became active in the Old Bayview School PTA. Mrs. King was instrumental in the building of the school, now known as Charles Drew Elementary. In 1959, she became a member of the Bayview Hunters Point Coalition Parent Action Group that aggressively pursues matters in the community that relates to the welfare of the child. During the late 60s, while helping her brother in his store, Mrs. King became cognizant of the problems people had of not being aware of the services available to support their needs. Through research, she became involved with the Economic Opportunities Council, known as the EOC, and has been actively involved in distributing food through the Senior Food Program. At the same time, she works distributing food for anyone in need in a program called Temporary Food Assistance. In 1980, she assisted in forming the Bayview Hunters Point Democratic Club to address issues and needs in the community. She has been president since 1995 of that organization. Mrs. King actively worked to help elect Willie Brown and increase voter registration in the Bayview Hunters Point community. The Democratic Club awards numerous scholarships every year to students of all ethnic origins. Mrs. King is a board member of the San Francisco Neighborhood Legal Foundation, an organization that gives free legal assistance to all. Since 1985, Mrs. King has taught a senior citizen exercise class at the Bayview Hunters Point Multicultural Senior Center. And since 1951, she has been a member of the Friendship Baptist Church in South San Francisco. Mrs. King is truly an unsung hero who deserves recognition for years of devotion and hard work for the members of our community. Mrs. King.
I'd just like to say, I just would like to thank the committee for choosing me. A lot of things that, you know, you do in the community, you don't realize people are noticing. You just start just going so much until you think, you know, it's just a part of life. But then there's someone watching, and I'm glad that someone actually saw me. Because sometimes you think that no one see all the things that you do. But I also like to thank the women's that set this up and providing refreshments and stuff, and really thinking about all of us. And I just appreciate this to the highest. And those that just really looked over and out in the community and see so many needs. And I think the world would be much better if we all would just take a look around, and there is something that you can do also. Just don't always point the finger. Get out there. There's plenty, plenty to be done, especially now that we having this welfare reform. It's going to take all of us to try to make it work. So get on your job and join us. Thank you.
The next awardee, Eric Dupree, could not be with us today because he's ill, but he's being well represented by, of course, his mother, Ella Price, and by a nephew, Carlton Dupree. Will they please come forward? Eric Dupree is spearheading the lead of a 40-year-old institution into the 21st century. He is an activist at heart, a consultant by trade, and an administrator in practice. He has paved the way for young people and technological innovators to take the African American Historical and Cultural Society and all people to the next level and beyond. Eric also honors the elders, the pioneers who have paved the way before him and continue to lead us all. Eric educates and motivates everyone who enters the Historical Society through his inspirational tours, highlighting artifacts and relating shared experiences that tell the true story of a people. He also goes out to visit senior centers, schools, organizations, and individuals to speak, read poetry, provide historical information, give walking tours, and to document events and experiences on videotape. One visit with Eric leads to a spirited work relationship that extends throughout the community. He brings together educators, artists, and young people and others to share their resources, skills, and talents to produce events and more. He is a communicator, a networker, and an organizer who leaves no door closed and who strives to open access and maximum activity and opportunity. In 1997 alone, he has guided the career of a young singer, songwriter, who has been featured on the radio and in African American History Month events. He has produced a historic and innovative multimedia conference honoring innovators and pioneers. He has brought new members to an institution and is working on a 1998 National Preservation Conference. He trains young people to open their books after school and to do their homework, motivates them to write and read their poetry, and trains them in how to use a video camera and to conduct interviews. As one young person said in her nominating Eric, quote, makes us known in our communities so that we will all be more interested in doing things throughout our communities. He builds lives, institutions, and communities, close quote. Let us recognize that unsung hero through his representatives, his mother and nephew.
Thank you.
Good evening.
He has stage fright. Good afternoon. Carlton and I are here to accept this award on Eric's behalf. Eric is home with the flu. He has a very bad case of the flu. But in his absence, we'd like to say thank you for honoring Eric with this award. Thank you very much.
The third awardee, and we'll break after this one for some more entertainment, also is not with us today, but I believe we have a substitute. Yes. And that's, the awardee is Shirley Jones, and the person who represented her would please come forward. I've had the pleasure of knowing Shirley for at least, I would say, 30 years. I don't want to date her, but I know it's been at least that long. Well, since I've been in the community 49 years, that still leaves her as a young person. She's lived in San Francisco for most of her life and in the Bayview Hunters Point for over 20 years. She is a mother of five daughters, grandmother of six. She has been the executive director of CAHED, the California Association of Health, Education, Employment, and Dignity for 26 years and is the epitome of community activism. Before CAHED became a nonprofit in 1978, it was known as the San Francisco Welfare Rights Organization. Besides advocating for women on AFDC, this organization handled and distributed up to $12 million in food stamps when no one else would. Since then, Ms. Jones, as the executive director, has been involved in the development and implementation of numerous projects and programs which serve the needs of the Southeast community. And she is an expert in community health care services aimed at addressing the needs of minority communities. She's been active in the Bayview Hunters Point area, as I said, for many years, and is one of our most respected leaders. She presently is the chairperson of the Bayview Hunters Point Shipyard Advisory Committee. Many of you may know, do know, that the shipyard, of course, is being turned over to San Francisco. And Shirley wants to make sure that the African-American community is well represented in the development of whatever development that takes place in that area. And so she's been put countless hours and much work in watching over the changes taking place at the shipyard. She's also president of the board of directors of the Young Community Developers. She's on the board of directors of the Bayview Hunters Point Community Defenders. And she's a member of the National Association of Community Health Centers Enterprise Council, just to name a few. Currently, she is, CAHEAD is a lead agency for the Southeast Family Support Network, a collaborative made up of 14 agencies that service the Southeast community. The network has just been awarded a community challenge grant in excess of $600,000 to implement teen pregnancy prevention programs. Under her guidance, the organization has survived in a time when the axe has fallen, as we know, on many social programs as a result of the conservative Congress we have. So, in my opinion, and I hope you will share with the committee, and it's your opinion also, that she is truly an unsung hero.
Good afternoon, everyone. On behalf of Shirley Jones and her family, I'd like to thank all of you and the San Francisco Library for this honor. Thank you.
I think we'll go back to the program. And if you notice, we have a dance and drum troupe, Adigun, Sipho, Angola, Capoeira.
Okay, good afternoon. I'm Terry Baruti, and I'm the director of Adigun Sipho Angola Capoeira Dance Troupe. Today, we have a special guest to bless this program, since we're bridging the gap of African history. We have one of our ancestors from the Congo, who is my instructor, my drum instructor, and our dance instructor. And he's a master drummer, master singer, and master choreographer. He's a former director of the Congolese National Ballet. I want to introduce to you Master Sandor Jibakawezi from the Congo. So that we can hear some of our traditional music right from the root of the tree, not from the leaves, but right from the root, fresh out the soil. So we hope that you're going to enjoy what you're about to see and what you're about to hear. And it's very important that we understand the connection of our ancestry. I consider myself not only an African American, but a New World African, because they kidnapped our ancestors out of the old world and brought us over here to the new world. So what we are, New World Africans. That means you can be anything: Cuban, Puerto Rican, Jamaican, from Chicago, from Cleveland, from Canada. We're New World Africans. Thank you.
Our next awardee, Gaylon Logan Jr. Someone represent? Okay. Mr. Logan has resided in the Baby Hunters Point for most of his 32 years. From his experience as a youth, years of being a single parent, and close to 8 years of working in and around the San Francisco Unified School District as an advisor, his organization, called Infusion One, was created. It was founded in 1994, and it's a nonprofit community-based volunteer organization whose mission is to empower at-risk youth living in the southeast section of San Francisco. Through programs and community forums, Infusion One seeks to stimulate dialogue and develop activities that promote positive change in the lives of youth and their families. Infusion One current programs include, one, Life Skills in America, an elementary and middle school program that is founded on the basic principles of responsibility, respect, and reality. Second, Academic and Athletic Olympics, a seasonal event for elementary school children that offers a fun way to learn the virtues of being a balanced individual by combining academics and athletic competitions. Three, Youth Speakers Bureau, a program which provides intensive public speaking and leadership training for youth ages 11 to 20. Besides being a single father of three, Gaylon is also a member of SIMBA, an African-American male mentoring program, and a co-facilitator of a proactive fathers group at Burnett Elementary School. As a member of the Southeast Community Collaborative, Gaylon will be taking on the responsibility of forming the Bayview Hunters Point Youth Council, which will be part participating in the citywide Youth Empowerment Conference put on by the mayor in May. He is a true advocate and a true unsung hero for our youth, who has dedicated his time and efforts to raising their self-esteem and broadening their horizons. For a young man and a black male, he is really to be rewarded. Come.
I'm nervous as hell, excuse me. I just want to start first off by giving thanks to my creator. And secondly, for all of the elders who are currently present and not present. There were so many things that I wanted to say this afternoon, but I'm going to stick with just a couple. First of all, this is an Unsung Hero Award, and I just want to share with all of you that there's been a song being sung in my heart, which continues to sing loud, which is both peaceful and also angry, which has guided me to do what I do. Last night, I went and saw a movie called Rosewood. Thank you very much. I might not have the title right, but I got the content of the movie. And it was something that I didn't want to, it was one of those kind of movies that you don't like to see, but you have to see. I just want to end by asking if you all would indulge me. Infusion One is based on three principles, which are respect, responsibility, and reality. Those are three things that seem to be missing to a large degree in our society today. But I also missing very much so in our youth today. I would like to ask if you would join in with me. We have a pledge, which is a life's pledge. If you all would join me in reciting that. Is that all right? It starts out like this. I will always strive, to respect myself, others, and my environment.
I understand that respect
is brethren to responsibility. And that I must continuously take responsibility for my thoughts,
actions,
successes,
and failures.
I understand that brethren
cannot
and will not
exist without sister reality.
I understand that I must always base my life choices
on nothing other
than what is real,
not fantasy
or make-believe. Now, I make this pledge
for
no other person
other than me,
myself and I,
for the purpose
of achieving
greater harmony
and success
and love
for myself and others. Thank you.
The next awardee is Susie Lucas. She will come forward. She is the Ocean View Ingleside District's unofficial scribe, a low-profile activist who puts her excellent writing skills at the service of the people of the community. A retired federal employee, a mother of eight, grandmother of 13, great-grandmother of nine, Mrs. Lucas, still works. She still works part-time as a medical secretary. After hours, she somehow finds time to write and edit the newsletter of the Ocean Ingleside Lions Club. Serves as secretary of the Bay Area Service League, volunteers with OMI Pilgrim Senior Center, OMI Neighbors in Action, Senior Action Network, Big Brothers Big Sisters of San Francisco, Christmas in April, and the list goes on. What makes Mrs. Lucas really unique, though, is her unofficial, unsung role as letter writer and scribe for the community. People tell me the story and I put it in letter form. She makes it sound so easy. But Mrs. Lucas has put in countless hours helping community members in their dealing with city officials and departments, family and social services, civil and criminal courts. She has helped neighborhood activists publicize and organize by writing those vital letters to news organizations, churches, activist groups, and business leaders. Beyond this, she has given freely of her time to serve as advocate and go-between in personal matters, writing the letters of reference and character that help young people gain entrance to the college of their choice or land that job, or just writing the letters that smooth people's dealing with stores, banks, the electric company, etc. The community comes to Susie Lucas with problems and concerns, large and small, trusting her, quote, put it in writing, close quote, providing them with a strong, clear voice when they might otherwise go unheard. Susie Lucas is a true unsung hero.
Well, first I want to thank you, but I wanted to tell Dr. Coleman I was a little bit upset the way he called his honorees, making me, what, the fourth or fifth in line? Because that means I have to stand in the shadow of all these beautiful dancers and all these people have done so much. My goodness, I mean, true activists. And I just felt that what I do, as they say, I'm a low-key person, and I've been in Ocean Ingleside since 1960, and I've always been a part of it. Everything that goes on, you can believe I will be a part of it, you know. But what I need to say today, everybody has a gift. Everybody in this room has a gift that they can do. And thankfully, I am able to write good letters. And today, communication, you have to be able to write a letter, because you cannot take care of business on the phone, because you can't get to anybody on the phone nowadays. By the time you go through the press 1, 2, and 3, and I'm sorry, all of our operators are busy and this, that, and the other, if you have a complaint with someone or anything you want to say, you've almost forgotten what you wanted to say because you've been on the phone so long. So this is the reason why, to be able to write letters for people who have problems, or, and we always write letters about problems. So this is where I really am able to help my community, and in other ways too, but I really do love, somebody says, Susie, I need a letter. Or I can be somewhere where things aren't quite right at a store, or Lucky's, anything, and I say, I think I feel a letter coming on. We have to do something about this, you know. So, just like Ms. King said, a lot of times you do things that people don't even pay any attention to, and that's the position I find myself in. So I'm really very honored to be able to be a part of this today and receive this award. Thank you.
The next honoree is Elnora Maybon. Ms. Maybon is a dedicated volunteer on behalf of homeless people and others who find themselves in need. She has been an active member of Pleasant Hill Baptist Church for 50 years and currently serves on the board of directors of the United Council of Human Services. For 10 years, she served as a foster grandparent visiting seriously ill children at San Francisco General Hospital. Every Saturday evening, you will find Elnora Maybon in the Tenderloin District serving dinner to homeless people at Hospitality House. During the week, she catches the bus to deliver books to homeless shelters. Somewhere in between these activities, she finds time to act as clothing distribution manager for the United Council of Human Services, providing free clothing to those in need on Pacific Islands as well as here at home. In the words of her friends and fellow volunteers, Elnora Maybon is a 73-year-old with the energy of a 30-year-old, a tower of strength. All who know her agree that she is one of the true unsung heroes of San Francisco.
Obedience to God and to each one that's present, to Dr. Coleman, no end to my gratitude for this award. I enjoy my work. I believe it's my calling. I see so much suffering among the homeless people. So I just keep on going, going, going. Thank you.
I believe at this time we have a 10-minute intermission. You can stand, stretch your legs. You have to make a pit shot. Stop, it's right around the corner. Just don't be too long. Let's get back so we can get started within 10 minutes, please.
Thank you. Recognize. You guys ready to tell them?
Yeah.
Let's go.
How?
They need to hear a little louder than that. Come on.
How do? How do you recognize a child of God?
Come on, let's hear it.
How?
Well, Simon can't hear you. Come on, let's go.
How do?
Come on.
How do you recognize a child?
This has truly been an inspirational day, at least for me. Well, our next honoree is Dr. Martha McHenry. She gave service in public education as a teacher and counselor in the elementary, middle, and high schools of San Francisco for almost 40 years, monumental. 40 years of raising the minds, hearts, and souls of young people. She began her teaching career in Austin, Texas, at the elementary school she attended as a child. After moving to San Francisco, she continued to teach in the elementary division. She also served as a counselor and summer school administrator for special classes, a counselor on a team for middle schools, and an educational counselor for a high school in San Francisco. She earned a bachelor's degree from Tillotson College in Austin and a master's degree from San Francisco State University. She received a cultural doctorate in literature from World University in 1990. She continues to raise, I'm a little ahead of myself there. She continues to raise the minds and hearts of us all as the coordinator of the bi-monthly open poetry readings, the annual African-American History Month poetry festival, and the youth poetry readings for the African-American Historical and Cultural Society. She founded this program, which is now in its fifth year. Poets and would-be poets all have an opportunity to read, in the words of nominator Eloise McKinney Johnson, quote, Dr. McHenry has given generously of her talents, her time, and her personal funds to establish in the poetry readings a positive community resource that is already a tradition wherein she consistently reminds participants, no profanity, please, end of quote. She is the author of three books, Golden Books, Book of Poems, Living Poems in Today and Time to Read, Short Stories for Young People. She has been described as a superior poet. She's also a dedicated member of Third Baptist Church, Zeta Phi Beta Sorority, and the National Council of Negro Women. She attends meetings and produces events year-round, but still finds time to travel to literary and other conferences to bring us even more education and inspiration. Let us raise up in celebration to honor this mind, heart, and soul raiser, Dr. Martha McHenry, Unsung Hero.
Thank you. Also, thank you to the persons on the committee that accepted me for this award. Thank you to those who submitted my name. I am we are beginning our fifth year as the coordinator. I was the founder of the organization, as I started to say it before and didn't. And now we are beginning our fifth year as the coordinator. We give this program bi-monthly. It's a community project. We reach out in the community. We invite people, anyone who writes poetry. Many people who read their poetry are published authors, but not all of them. If you'd like to read your poetry, you may come. We only have one standard rule, no profanity. We are there from 7 to 9. It's a program that we want everyone to come and really enjoy and participate. Poetry makes a contribution to human understanding, which creates a better world for all of us. And let us look into poetry more. And please let the little children also learn to read and write poetry. The ever since we've had this program, the month of May has been dedicated to young children. That's our Youth Night program. So May 8th, I think it is, the 13th, whatever the second Thursday is, at 7 o'clock, bring all of your little children to 762 Fulton Street and let them read their poetry or listen to others. If they listen to others, they will also be motivated to read. So I thank you for this opportunity.
The next awardee is Will Reno. He will come forward. It's a name everyone in the Ocean View Ingleside community recognizes, a community businessman, activist, humanitarian, and friend. Reno came to San Francisco in 1959 after he was honorably discharged from the Navy. He settled in the Ocean View Ingleside area in 1960 and opened Reno's community barbershop in 1967. The barbershop today is a clearinghouse for community concerns. He immerses himself in the community and takes a leadership role in the solution of its problems. He is responsible for obtaining refuse containers on Broad Street and bus stop shelters in the OMI area. He works with a Southwestern Neighborhood Improvement Group called SNIG, co-founded in 1976, and the OMI Lions Club organized in 1985. These groups provide Thanksgiving dinner for senior citizens, a toy giveaway at Christmas, an Easter egg hunt, and annual trips for underprivileged neighborhood kids to Raging Waters, Great America, and the Santa Cruz Boardwalk. He serves as a role model and mentor to African-American children and youth from female-headed households. His involvement in these children's lives frequently deters poor performance in and abandonment of academic pursuits. Whenever he is needed, he lends a helping hand, frequently reaching into his own pocket and giving of his personal resources. When crisis strikes the community, the first question asked is, does Reno know about it? A child has not been fed, see Reno. A mother, for hundreds of reasons, does not have all the rent money and is threatened with eviction, see Reno. Government and the vast bureaucracy is wielding the big stick of authority. There is a community meeting to see what can be done about it. Count on Reno to be there, leading the discussion, fully exploring the possibilities, advising, swapping ideas within the group, calling just the right person to get their take on the situation. His devotion and commitment to building and strengthening the community and its people are unconditional and ongoing. We can never repay his kind of service. We can only honor him, and we do so today as an unsung hero. Mr. Reno.
Thank you very much, and I am surprised and honored to receive this award. I have done quite a lot of work throughout the communities and throughout all the communities, Bayview, Hunters Point, and the Fillmore area, but I've done most of my work in the Ingleside area. I'd like to thank everyone here who has supported me and wrote my name in to receive this award. I actually received this award for the Ocean Ingleside community, because without them, I wouldn't be here accepting this award. The Ocean Ingleside Lions Club, which sits there. Mr. Robinson, who told me he couldn't make it today because he had to babysit. God knows he made it. Thank you, Mr. Robinson. Naomi Williams, who is the coordinator and planner to help me with the trips that we take to Santa Cruz, Great America, and the likes, with all the kids, 160 kids per trip. Her and her mother's here, and I thank them both. I thank everyone in here who is here to provide and help community needs as they see fit. Thank you very, very much.
At this point, we will be entertained by the dance and drum troupe. I believe they're ready.
Good evening again. Now, this is the second half of Adigun Sipho's production. What we're going to do now is another dance number from the Congolese set. And the dance is choreographed by Mrs. Lorraine Bowser-Baruti, who works in the Bayview community at Gloria Davis. And maybe Gloria Davis School might take in consideration to use some of the people that are in the community to teach our children in their own community. That would be kind of nice. It would also be kind of nice with a little support for Adigun Sipho, who's been in the Bayview district for a number of years and have been existing for 12 years. So we are there, and we're waiting for you to bring your children and waiting for you to show up yourself. And maybe if we utilize some of our own community assets, we'll have a little more going. So we appreciate the opportunity to be here and to join our spirit. Please have a good time. Enjoy the dance and the music. We'll be showing you some Capoeira Angola, which is a rite of passage dance that come from the same Bantu people that originated the Congolese style dance that we do. And it was a dance to initiate the young men who were picked by their elders to set into manhood. There were females who were picked by their elders to step into womanhood, and they would do a separate dance, and the young men would do a dance called Ungulu. And Ungulu means zebra dance, which was reminiscent of the zebras when the males fight for dominance during mating season. So the Bantu people took elements of that dance and made it into a rite of passage dance. Because in that society, you just didn't marry because you wanted to. You had to first be groomed and picked by your elders. And that means if you were a young man, it wasn't your father. Because your father could be prejudiced and say that he feels you're ready simply because you are his son. So it had to be one of his elders, either his father or his older uncle, or maybe the chief of the village. Same for the young ladies. It would have to be your mother's mother or your mother's auntie or the senior elder female of the community would pick your daughter. So I think it would be good if we would bring some of these elements back into our community. And one thing about these different arts and these styles of music and dance is something that you can do that's spiritual and that is relative to your existence that you could do every day. You don't have to talk with your mouth and then do something different. You can live it every day. It could be a part of your spirituality that you can practice. So let us get right to the dance.
Thank you. But it's the controller of the dance. He gives all the messages. He tells all the signals. Always before we die, we sing a prayer. Respect our ancestors who died in the quest of freedom, in the quest of struggle, who made a free people, who have their own name, who have their own way of life, and to connect themselves with their own nation.
That was a wonderful presentation. I'm sure we all enjoyed it. And one more round of applause. The hour is getting late, and the library does close at 5, I believe, today. So we're going to move the program along, and we have two more awardees. The next one is Dwayne Robinson, if he'll come forward. He grew up in Bayview Hunters Point and has been involved in mentoring and counseling youth for a number of years. As an assistant basketball coach at City College and a head coach with the Adult Basketball Midlight League in the early 1990s, he gained the ability to motivate players to their peak performances. This skill was easily transferable for mentoring and counseling at-risk youth. Dwayne is a role model that young men can especially identify with, for he has been where many of these youth find themselves. As a prevention specialist with Bayview Hunters Point Youth Service, he had the task of tracking students in attendance and grades. At that same time, he was also a counselor for the home detention program, where his duties included aggressive monitoring of youth to ensure compliance with court orders. He has been a tutor and counselor with the Family Prosaic Project and the San Francisco Educational Services. He is currently a coordinator for the Bayview Hunters Point Healthy Start Collaborative, which works with the 6 elementary schools in the community to promote the health of the total child mentally, emotionally, as well as physically. Dwayne is also executive director and owner of the Bayview Barbers College, which will be opening this summer, providing jobs and training to youth in the Bayview Hunters Point. Also, he is a member of, I suppose you pronounce it CAG, C-A-G, Community Advisory Group for the Muni Light Rail on 3rd Street. And he's also involved with the Enterprise Zone Council. He's a youth member of that. So without further ado, I'd like to introduce Dwayne as an unsung hero, as well as being married and the father of 5.
I'd like to give thanks and foremost to our Creator, God Almighty. I'd like to give a special thanks to my grandmother. I'd like her to stand up. For if not her, I would not be here today. She's 89 years old. She's a very inspiration to me. Working in Bayview, it was really hard in the beginning when I was first took on the job of working with youth, trying to get them in school and try to realize the realization of what their lives and their future would be. But as I go throughout Bayview and throughout the city working with our youth, I think that all of us have a tendency to look at the ones who hang out on the corners as being bad. But just as we saw today, the kids who were up here, they could be one of these kids who were up here today. But I would like to keep this short. And one of the things that I really want to get to the point was my son right here. This is my baby son right here. And Jonathan wants to say something. What do you say? Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay.
And the last awardee is Larry Gray. Should athletes be role models for young people? Do they have any social responsibilities beyond negotiating the best contracts they can get for themselves? That question has been debated in newspaper columns and radio and TV sports talk shows. Today, we're honoring an athlete for whom there has never been any doubt about the answer to those questions. Coach Larry Gray has been using his talent to help kids in his community for over 20 years. Following high school graduation, Gray divided his time between continuing his education and playing professional basketball, including a stint in the NBA with the LA Lakers. Probably needed him up here with the Warriors, but he was down there. He earned a bachelor's degree from Evansville University in Indiana and a master's degree from San Francisco State, majoring in secondary education. He coached basketball at Redwood High School, City College of San Francisco, and in San Francisco Pro-Am Summer Leagues. At the same time, he was a recreation coordinator at Ella Hill Hutch Community Center in the Western Addition. There he was a co-founder of the highly successful Midnight Basketball Program. This program is not just about basketball. Its participants also get GED preparation, employment training, and hope and purpose for the future, thanks to Larry's vision and commitment. Larry is presently director of athletics at Balboa High School. He also gives to Capricorn, a nonprofit organization he has founded. Capricorn operates as a referral service, contacting coaches to alert them to promising student athletes, girls as well as boys. Larry Gray was nominated for this award by more than a dozen young people. Their respect and regard for him is apparent. Quote, "He's always helping kids stay out of trouble," close quote. Quote, "He helped put me on the right track," close quote. Quote, "Many are able to look up to Coach Gray," close quote. These are typical of the comments they make about him. We're proud to honor you as an unsung hero. You're being presented as last, but that doesn't mean you're still not first. Okay.
First of all, I'd like to give honor to my creator, because we know without him, I would not be here today. I'd like to give honor also to Jimmy McNeil, who sort of, I won't say tricked me, but he sort of got to me by asking me for my resume, and I never knew why. He said he was going to send it to some coaches because there were some jobs that was available. Because myself, I just believe that what I'm doing is part of my life's work. I don't feel like I'm doing anything that should be recognized. It's just something that's a part of my daily work. But I wanted to say that with our student athletes, especially the African Americans, I'm trying to help them get their fair due. What I mean by that is we do not have enough African-American student athletes leaving San Francisco, going to college. And my goal is, as director of athletics at Balboa, to make sure that our young people get their rightful due, get their grades up, and be recognized as students, athletes second. Thank you.
At this point, I would like to turn the program over to Joan Jackson, who is an honorary unsung hero.
Thank you, Dr. Coleman. I have a lot of people to thank. And I think I will begin with the other librarians who worked with me on this program this year. You know, this is the 9th annual, and this program began in 1989, 9 from 7, that's when it began. and it began at the Western Addition Library, which I'm very proud to say is the library that I'm the manager of. And this is the first year that we've had a librarians committee to work on it. And I think that it's been 4 times as successful this year because of that. These are the members of the committee. Darkus Thomas,
of Ocean View Branch. Amy Holloway, who is the librarian of the African American Center here in the Main Library. And you already met Linda Brooks Burton, who is the manager of the Bayview Wadden Branch. And we four would all very much like to thank Dr. Coleman for doing such a wonderful job. And to show our appreciation, we have a gift certificate for you, Dr. Coleman, from Marcus Bookstore. So thank you. Thank you.
Well, before I close, there is another unsung hero, and I would not dare leave here without introducing her, and that's my wife, Renee.
I'm not quite finished yet. in addition to the hardworking librarians committee, we also had a great deal of help from a number of people in our communities, and I would like you to meet them now. Where's my list? Majoria Louise Dickey. She's standing in back. Miriam Pavis, Miriam. Dorothy Strickland. Donald Ray Young. I haven't seen Donald Ray this afternoon. I don't think he was able to be here, but he was a tremendous amount of help and has been for years in putting this program together. And another person who has been a big help for years, who may also not be in the room, and that's Martha Thibodeau, who is the member of the National Council of Negro Women, who has been with me since, what was that year? Who figured it out? When did this book? 1988. Martha and I have been working together on this program, and Martha is in the room across the hall, supervising the preparation of a fabulous reception with a banquet. I've been over there and I've had some samples, and I can tell you, there is plenty and it's delicious, and we want you all to go over there and have some in a minute when I finish talking. I would also like to introduce, if she's in the room still, Marcia Snyder, who's the chief of branches for the library. Is she there? She is. She's waving. Hi, Marcia. And she's just been out helping us get permission to stay here late, so that we don't have to get out of here by 5 o'clock. We can stay later. I would also, at this time, I would like to introduce Sharon Johnson. Ms. Johnson, you've waited a long time for this moment. It's come. Ms. Johnson is from Assemblyman Kevin Shelley's office. Please come.
Thank you, Joan. Thank you, Dr. Coleman, and the great committee, but especially thank you to all of the unsung heroes that were mentioned today, and for all of those of you that are out there doing the work of for the community and behalf of yourselves and your families. Unfortunately, Assemblyman Kevin Shelley cannot be here with you today, but he asked me to send his best regards to all of you. And I have certificates of recognition from the California State Assembly that I will leave with Joan so that you may collect them. And congratulations and thank you.
Oh, they're very nice. I also have certificates from Senator Quentin Kopp's office. Senator Quentin Kopp's office did not send anyone here, but they sent over their certificates. So award winners, please stop by and see me at the reception, and you get your certificates. And now I wish to introduce someone who's been very dear to me for a long time. This lady was one of the very first Unsung Hero Award winners, and she's been helping us ever since then. This is Vera Clanton. She is the president of the Northern California Life Members Guild of the National Council of Negro Women. And from Ms. Clanton.
Thank you, Joan. Joan is one of the most giving women that I know. She has given to this community, the Western Addition, since 1889 and before, but we brought it to the public in 1889. This, oh, I'm sorry. You know, listen, this is very important. I just got through with this Black History Month, visiting the schools, talking about Frederick Douglass, Sojourner Truth, and all these 1889. So it's a part of me right now. But anyway, you know, I would like to say for Joan and that committee that worked with the Unsung Hero since 1989, they have done a marvelous job. And the National Council of Negro Women has been a co-partner with them. We have served with them in more ways than one. And you know, it takes a good cook to sometimes keep the audience together. See, all of you are going to stay here now until you go in that reception room. And you should, because it's very, very beautiful. But Martha Thibodeau, as she stated, is our second vice president of the Golden Gate section, and she has worked on the committee and also in sharing with the food. So she's in there now. But one of the things I had to say about Joan, I got to find my little notes. She's a courageous woman because she has stood up and went through with this for 8 years over in the Western Addition at the library, 1550 Scott Street, where we were cuddled in there between books, but we had a beautiful celebration each year. But this year, look at us. We have the big auditorium. So now next year, I'm sure we'll be here again. So we are so pleased to have the Ocean View, Ingleside, Bayview, and Hunters Point. And you know, I was so glad to see them today because all of them remember me when I was working with their children. So now, when I saw them today, everybody remembered me, even when I was a Robinson. But you know, I'm glad to see you because I'm getting up there and I'm forgetting faces, but not, I'm forgetting names, but not faces. So I'm very pleased to be with you. So I got to tell you just a little bit about the National Council of Negro Women. It is a council of 34 organizations called affiliates and 250 community-based sections. And that is, we're not leaving out anyone, men and women. Men, we need you, and you are our affiliates. We're so glad to see Clerkley over there. He's one of our life legacy. No, he's a life member, a life associate member with us. So men, join him. That means that he paid the $300. But anybody can be a member. and support us each year at $25. So we're going to have application blanks and more information. I even had a sheet printed because I knew I wouldn't have time to say the things I wanted to say. So we are going to have a sheet. It'll be over in the social hall. I'll be sitting at a table. So you come by and see me, and I'll tell you much more about the National Council of Negro Women. So thank you very much for this little time. Also, I want to say thank you to Dr. Coleman. He's one that helped me with my little girls also. So thank you.
I just happened to see that, I believe that's Martha Thibodeau in the back there in blue. We've already thanked you, Martha, but at least wave so everyone knows it's you. And I think, oh, I have one more person to thank. I saw her a minute ago. Carolyn Cooley, who has been the stage manager here today. Where is she? Where did she go? There she is. Hi, Carolyn. She did a wonderful job. I don't think we could have done this program without you, Carolyn. And of course, to Dave Schwabe, who's videoing the program. And I believe people who want tapes, if you get in touch with one of the members of the committee, we'll make sure that you are able to get one. You want one? Okay, good. Well, you just let us know. We'll make sure you get one. You know something? I feel bad. I was going to urge everyone to go up to see the African American Center on the third floor. I know it was mentioned earlier, but I wanted to reinforce that. I don't think we can do that now, can we, Amy? The library closes at 5, so I don't think we can go up there today. But I urge everyone to go back and see it. It's a wonderful place, and we thank Dr. Coleman very much because he was so instrumental in raising the money to achieve it. I think that's all the talking I have to do, but of course there's still a very important part of the program left, and that is the reception. That will be held when you go out the door outside. You want to sort of go to your left, not a hard left, but sort of diagonally to your left to the Latino Hispanic room. And that is where the banquet and reception is. And I hope that while we're in there, I hope that people who've received awards, we could kind of gather and have a photo opportunity for the group. That concludes my remarks. Anyone else?